Hi, I'm Ben Marriott. This is my intern Kimchi, and welcome to the very first episode of Animating Great Artists, where this week we'll be breaking down the process of animating the amazing work of Furry Little Peach. Here's what we'll be making. Let's begin. In this series, I have shown motion designers how to approach animating illustrations of different styles, and hopefully show some illustrators how to begin thinking about animating their own work and where to start. In this episode, we're going to tackle the wonderful, happy world of Furry Little Peach. She's a brilliant artist, illustrator, and author based in Sydney. She has an amazing YouTube channel where she vlogs about her process, her studio, and life as an artist. Her work has this very unified, wholesome optimism that's brought together mainly through these really gorgeous watercolors. We had a chat and thought it would be cool to bring to life this cute house character that pops up through a lot of her work. Alright, so I'm going to try to make a short looping animation of this house sort of scrunching down, bouncing up, doing a little spin at the top, and then falling back down and feeling very chuffed with itself. Because the character is relatively simple in structure, and I want to keep the hand-drawn look from Sean, I'm going to do the main motion traditionally frame by frame in Photoshop, and then add texture and finish things up here, back in After Effects. So I've got my reference layer up here, and I've eyedropped a few of the colors so I can easily access them later. Now the panel down here, you might not recognize, that is called Anim Desen 2, and that is essentially for making frame by frame animation in Photoshop much, much easier. This plugin is completely free, and I'll link to where you can get it down in the description. Click this button down here to make a video timeline, and then this button. To make the equivalent of a layer, you click this button, which creates a video group. Click this button here to zoom in. You can click either one of these two buttons to create a new frame. This one creates a new frame that's one frame long. This one creates a frame that's two frames long. I'm going to be using this one because I like animating on twos, because it's a little more manageable and I prefer the look. This first stage is going to be a rough pass of the animation, where I'm going to draw pretty loose just to make sure the movement feels right. And I'm going to draw the first position of the house, where the animation is going to start and end. Alright, so this is roughly how a main house character is going to look. Now I'm going to draw the extremes, which is where the house is going to be at its lowest point, anticipating before the jump, at its highest point, where it jumps, where it spins around, and then at its lowest point when it falls back down again. I'm turning my onion skins on here, which means I can see a faded version of the frame before, and this just helps make sure that the animation, each frame is going to line up with the previous frame and not jitter all over the place. Alright, now if we scrub through the animation, we can kind of see the rough path of movement that a house is going to take. So it's going to squash down at the beginning, zoom up in the middle here, get really skinny, and at the top, it's going to do a bit of a spin around here, fall back down, squash, and then back to its resting position. Now you'll notice it's squashing and stretching here. Squash and stretch is one of the 12 principles of animation, and it just adds a little more character and exaggeration to the movement, which I think works really well for this little character here. Now on a new layer, I'm just going to rough out some guides, which are going to help me dictate the overall pace of how the jump's going to feel, and how many frames to include during each section. So as the tip of the house swings down, it's going to swing down into this last position here, and we're going to have a keyframe in the middle, and then one either side, and we're going to draw more frames towards the start and the end here, which should give us that sense of easing into this motion. And from here, our house is going to explode up, and we're going to take this path, so we're going to have end here, sit here as well, one closer, and maybe one more closer still. I think we'll have one more frame where the tip of the house sits here before it gets to its maximum spinning position. And it'll do a few twirls in the air here, and then come back down, and I want it to come back down pretty straight. So we're going to have a final position here, one where it starts there, let's have another here, and maybe a couple down here as it eases in. Now these are just guides. Once we add the frames, we're going to see how the movement actually sits and how it starts to feel, and from there we can tweak and make adjustments. So let's make that layer fairly transparent. There we go. Now I've just gone through and colored these frames on our house rough layer blue. This is so I can look down at a glance and see where our extreme keyframes are, and that our regular frames will just be colored purple, like this. Now I'm going to go through and draw all our in-between positions on these main extremes. Now Now I've done the in-betweens for this first transition. Now I've got a house starting here, and we've got 5 frames of it transitioning into this down extreme over here. To make it look like it's easing into that movement, the first image is very similar to that first one, then it moves very slightly towards the middle, then one of it completely facing the front, and then the last two almost exactly into this last position. Now when we play back, we can kind of see the pace of the animation and certainly how this first starting scene is going to look. Now let's go and do that for the rest of these transitions. Alright, I'm happy with this. Now I'm just going to go back through and add stuff like the chimney and the face to all of the frames, because I was ignoring that for the most part, just so I could get the movement right. Otherwise, just extra work drawing in the faces and chimneys into frames that, you know, might end up on the cutting room floor. Alright, so let's go through and do that. I've made his facial expression change a little bit during the scene, so when he goes down, he starts, you know, crunching his eyes up like he's preparing for preparing to do this jump, and as he jumps he's sort of excited and surprised, and then he becomes sort of happy when he lands, like, you know, that was a thrilling adventure he's just been on. I think that it adds, you know, a little bit more character, and I think it's a good idea to look for those little moments when you can add more character to your characters. I'm going to add a few more secondary elements to this animation to help sell the movement a little bit more. So I'm going to add this, you know, sort of puff of smoke kind of coming out of the chimney here. Now I'm also going to add some extra sort of lines and kind of like sparkles that Furry Little Peach has a lot in her illustration. So I think they'll sort of help sell the design language of this living in her universe. Alright, I think we're done for our rough stage here. Now that I'm happy with everything, I can move on from here to create the final pieces of the animation. It's good practice that before you move on from the rough stage of your animation, that all the thinking is done. You know where all the elements are going to be, and you know the timings of everything. This is because the next stage, where we're adding in the colours and sort of making the final pieces for our animation, is we don't want to be doing much thinking, because this is the most tedious part of the process, and you just want to be able to zone out, put on a podcast or an audiobook, and, you know, relax. Now I'm going to keep my colours separated on different layers, so I'm going to do a different layer for the house, a different layer for the roof and the chimney, a different layer for the face, and another layer for the smoke and the secondary elements as well. So let's go ahead and do those. Alright, I'm pretty happy with how everything looks now. One thing I did add is this secondary puff of smoke that comes up out of the chimney after the house sort of bounces back up after it falls down. And I just think that adds just, you know, a little bit extra character and, you know, always looking for more character. Now there's only one more thing we need to do in Photoshop before we move into After Effects to composite it all together. And that is to make a little watercolor texture that we're going to use. Now I've got myself one of Carl T. Webster's watercolor brushes here, and they come with Photoshop, I believe, now. I'm just going to draw a rough circular sort of shape that's getting darker in the middle. Okay. And I'm just going to make 4 of those. There we are. Now we've got 4 little watercolor sections, and the color doesn't matter here because we can change that in After Effects. Okay, let's save our file. We don't have to do anything special to this Photoshop file. We can just save it as a regular PSD, and After Effects will do all the rest. Alright, now that we're in After Effects, let's import our file by pressing Ctrl-I, selecting our file, and make sure we import as composition retain layer sizes. And click OK. Now we've got our main comp here, and you'll see that all our animation has been preserved. Now the first thing that I'm going to do is color code some of these layers, rename them, and just tidy up this project so it's easier to manage. Alright, that's a little nicer. One thing you will notice is that about 2.5 seconds in, our animation disappears. That's because our composition here is a little longer than we have frames for. So to trim this composition down to the right size, we find the last frame where our animation is visible, press N on our keyboard, which trims our work area, to our playhead, and right click trim comp to work area. Now it will loop back seamlessly. We've also got our watercolor texture here, so let's go inside that comp and make that useful. So inside here, we've got these four layers, which are where our texture is applied. Now when I made these, I thought 2 frames would be sufficient for these, but now I think I want these to be 4 frames long. So I'm just gonna select them all and then drag them out 2 frames. And then I'm gonna drag these into a sequence here. Just like our other comp, this comp is too long for our frames. So we're gonna press N here and trim comp to work area again. Awesome. Now let's drag these watercolor textures into the middle so it's a little easier to deal with. All right, great. Let's go back into our main comp. Now we want our watercolor composition to loop. So to do that, we're gonna right click and select time, enable time remapping, go to the frame before the last keyframe here, make a new keyframe, delete the last keyframe, hold Alt while clicking the stopwatch, click this arrow, click property, and click loop out. And that should loop our composition seamlessly. All right, wonderful. It might be a bit tedious, but I legit think that's the best way to do this in After Effects. All right, now we only want this texture to be visible on our house layer and specifically on this wall layer. So to do that, we're gonna drag that above our walls layer, duplicate our walls layer, and use that as an alpha mat. So we select our watercolor layer and under track mat, select alpha mat, which uses the layer above, which we're gonna rename walls mat, and color it purple just so I can see what the mats are at a glance. And now we see it's only taking up the area of our walls. Now we can also see it's really dark and black and muddy, and we don't want that. We want it to be just a slight shadow of this existing wall color. To do that, I'm gonna select curves over here in the effects and presets panel, and we're gonna select our red channel and just bump up the red in the shadows a fair bit. That seems all right. I'm also gonna lower the transparency on this to about 25. Maybe 35, that might be too subtle. Now that looks great, but when our house moves up, our watercolor texture stays down here. So we need to move it up with our house. So to do that, we're gonna make a position keyframe by pressing P, clicking the stopwatch, and as our house goes up, we're gonna drag our watercolor texture up here. And just before it falls down, make another keyframe. And when it falls down, let's copy that keyframe from the beginning, copy and paste. And now we should have our texture up in the air as well. Awesome. Now, we're gonna do the exact same thing for our roof layer. Now, I've added our watercolor texture to the roof, but it's still really red, so you can barely see it. So let's drag this curves down almost to the bottom. And now it's barely visible, but if we turn it on and off, you can see it's there. There we go. All right, now there's only one more thing that we need to do before this is done. And that's add a texture overlay to the whole thing. Now I have a texture overlay already prepared that I use in pretty much all of my animations. It's a piece of paper that I painted black and you've still got all this texture and bits of the paper showing through that I just scanned in. And then I've just got this rotated about 4 times and changed its position. So it looks like a new texture in each frame. Now we're gonna loop that using the same method as before. There we go, and we're gonna set that blending mode to screen. Now that'll only show the white areas of that comp. And it's pretty subtle at the moment, you can barely see a few of the white areas. So let's increase that with the curves layer and really bump up the white here. And let's crush the blacks a little bit as well. Now, let's make it more obvious. Let's play that back. All right, that is looking pretty good. If you used any of the techniques or processes you learned from this video in any of your animations or work, please upload it to Instagram and tag me at @ben_married_. I'd love to see what you make and I'd love to share it with my audience in my stories. Please let me know what other artists and illustrators you think would be great to feature in this series. I'd love to know what you think. And please don't forget to subscribe, hit that bell icon, share, and absolutely emulsify that like button. I'll see you next week.